We're so glad that you could be with us this morning. It's too wet for yard work anyway, so you might as well be inside, right? And gosh, while you're getting situated in your seat, if you've got a cell phone on you, if you make sure it's set to silent, please, that would be appreciated. And while you have it out, why don't you go ahead and check in on social media and let folks know that you're here and invite them to meet you some morning. And it's not too late for them to join you today online on Facebook, so please go to our feed. Tell your friends, go to our Facebook feed at First Federated Church. They can tune in and see what we're all about. Well, I invite you, if you are able, please stand. We're going to have a word of prayer, and we are going to sing. Gracious loving God, we thank you that you have brought us here this morning on this very wet Palm Sunday, and on this day when we think about a Jesus that triumphantly came into town and spent that week trying to get that last chance to change and save the world. How might we be brave enough to follow Jesus on that ride? So be with us today as we sing praises to you. Inspire us that we might be a more faithful people throughout this week, and help us see our way to next Sunday. All this we ask in his name. Amen.
Oh,
something special going on here, and I see some palm fronds out, and we've got some readers that are going to help us out here. Show you the secret here.
Lent began in the wilderness. It concludes in Jerusalem. We have followed Jesus this far. Today, we remember how he faced betrayal, falseness, rejection, and torment. And we witness once more that he taught and walked in love through every step of the journey. This is the entry into Jerusalem based on Luke 19.
Having said this, Jesus went ahead with the ascent to Jerusalem. Approaching Bethage and Bethany, near what is called the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of the disciples with these instructions.
Go into the village ahead. Upon entering it, you'll find a tethered colt that no one has yet ridden. Untie it and lead it back. If anyone should ask you, why are you untying it, say the rabbi needs it.
They appeared on their errand and found things just as Jesus had said. As they united the colt, untied the colt, owners said to them, "Why are you doing that?" They explained that the rabbi needed it. Then the disciples led the animal to Jesus and said, laying their cloaks on it, helped them out.
People spread their cloaks on the roadway as Jesus rode along. As they reached the descent from the Mount of Olives, entire crowd of disciples joined them and began to rejoice and praise God loudly for the display of power they had seen the same.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our God. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.
Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus,
"Teacher, rebuke your disciples."
Jesus replied,
"I tell you, if they were to keep silent, the very stones would cry out."
All right, thank you for listening to our short little meeting here. Hopefully, give us an idea of the entry into Palm Sunday in Jerusalem. And we're going to continue downstairs reading a little bit about Good Friday and skipping ahead a little bit.
Before we get on, okay, so we bring a little boxes up here to have one day out of sharing thing. One of those gestures. Oh, well, thank you. Wow, that's heavy. One more day of putting some change in. There we go. Well, this is great. Okay, we're going to start stacking these up on this bench right there. You can stack these up on top of each other if you want. So Jesus was riding into Jerusalem on the colt of a donkey. That's the way a king would come into a city a long time ago. It doesn't even make much sense that he'd be riding a donkey. That was to show how humble the king was and how good care of him was going to take care of people. But then kings didn't usually work out that way. But what Jesus was trying to teach was that he was a different kind of leader. And he was truly a humble leader. And one thing that was really important that he was trying to teach everyone, not just his disciples, but the importance of doing stuff like sharing. Like this really heavy box right here. This full of all kinds of change. It just takes everybody doing just a little bit. You know, there's, anybody have a guess how much money's in here? Is there $1 million in here? There's one yes for $1 million. Maybe $10, $5, maybe $100. Who knows how much is really in here? It's a pretty safe bet. Unless it's a check, it's not $1 million. And then I would be a little suspicious if it was a check for $1 million. I'm not sure who's pictured it beyond the check. But it's everybody doing just the little things of taking care of one another and sharing as best they can with other people that will really make a difference in the world. That if we're humble enough to do something for somebody else, that's what makes things better. And we've got one more. Do you want me to put that up over here for you? You want to put that up here for you? Or you want to keep it? It's up to you. You want to put it there yourself? You can do that. You can hold on to it. That's all right. So, today's the last day that we're doing the collection for the One Great Hour of Sharing. If somebody forgot to bring theirs in, by all means, bring it in next week. The money will always be blessed. But it's these little things. It's people your age all over the world today are bringing their money so that it can do all the wonderful things like providing clean water and safe homes and food for people all over the world that, for whatever reason, whether there was a storm or there was maybe a war, that people have lost everything, this helps them get through to the next day. So let's have a little prayer, and then you're joking again, and I understand there's a little bit of something going on downstairs. And when it comes time for the Easter egg hunt, you guys are doing that in the hall, you're going to be all the way downstairs. Okay? All right. So, dear God, we bring to you this money and ask your blessing that it will go wherever in the world that you want it to go, to bring help and to bring hope and to show our love. And all I got to show and say, amen. Thank you. this morning to see all these names that are on our list, some folks that you probably know very well, some maybe unknown to you, and so many different concerns. Some are, we have friends that are battling cancer and seeing a better prognosis. We have friends that have heart ailment issues, and then there's the struggles that so many have that their spirits feel like the dreariness of today. And all of them are very real. And so we pray for all of these things that maybe, you know, we don't necessarily have the answer for. We pray for guidance, and we pray that medicine can do what medicine can do, and that in the ways that we're able, that we can be present in somebody else's life and not turn away when they need us most. Today's a mix of all of these kinds of struggles that people have, and it's also a day that we celebrate the happiness of a couple from our congregation. You know, Susie and Brandon, they live in Texas. They came back here to be married yesterday, and we celebrate the joy of this new life together that they are sharing, and we pray that all of us can maybe grab a hold of a little piece of that joy and claim it for ourselves. But for all these things that are on your hearts and minds, let's come to God in prayer. Holy One, we gathered here this morning for whatever reasons it is that we came here. Perhaps we're struggling with a question that we have, and we're hopeful that in the sacredness of the space that answer might be revealed to us. We come here because we enjoy seeing all of these young faces that are here, and I hope for a brighter tomorrow that we have the children that share this space. We come here because we are eager to start our week among folks who are familiar to us, and to find out what was going on in the past week and what we have going on next week. And genuinely wanting to know how everyone is doing. We are here because of relationship. We know and love one another, and that is how we draw closer to you. Through whatever questions we have of why perhaps someone is growing distant from us, or why someone is pushing us away, or why the child isn't growing up the way that we're sure we taught them, or why does someone I love have to suffer? Help us find the answer in your presence, that no matter what the struggle is, that we may find the reassurance that there is comfort and hope. In living the life and the lessons that Jesus came to teach, that even if we lack the expertise to cure those that we love, they will know they are loved. That even We feel that what we do or say doesn't matter. You will show us how deeply we are loved by you. On this day that we bring to you this jumble of emotions, let us find our way to the joy that Susie and Brandon are sharing. Let us be reminded that every day brings us the opportunity to renew a vow, one to the other, that we will care for each other, that we will put their needs ahead of our own, and so find ourselves on the path that leads to you. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And let us begin with this prayer for strength. Oh God, you've given us life through Jesus Christ. Thank you for your love to us. Help us to know your love and love for each other. Give us enough tests to make us strong. Vision and endurance to follow your way. Enough patience to persist when it is difficult. Enough of reality to know our weaknesses. Go before us to prepare the way. Walk behind us to be our protection. And walk behind us to be our companion. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. It seems incredible that the disciples would get into this silly dispute over which one of them was the greatest, especially when you consider the setting, the Last Supper. They get into this argument after Jesus had just shared with them this ceremony that we now call communion. Passover meal, Jesus had announced that one of the 12 would betray him. And the disciples had responded by devolving into a round robin of who would do such a thing. Surely not I. No, said, well, it couldn't be me. And someone else said, me neither. And others said, well, I know it couldn't be me. Well, why not? You think you're better than the rest of us? Well, it's not me. I'm the one who went and got the master's ride in town when he told me to. And 5 days earlier, this day we call Palm Sunday, Jesus had ridden into Jerusalem to the cheers of a crowd that thought that Jesus was the leader they were looking for. A general who was going to lead an overthrow of the Romans. Now, the night before Jesus' execution, he has to go over the same ground he has covered before, and who knows how recently. Earlier in Luke, it is recorded how Jesus had to straighten these guys out on the same topic. It says, an argument arose among them as to which one of them was the greatest, in chapter 9, verse 46. I mean, okay, if this argument was a couple of years ago, I could see how they might not have a handle on his teaching just then. But now, after all this time they've been with him, I mean, how dense are these people? Well, aren't I just the best at criticizing them? How many of us get a lesson correct the first time around? I know there are several of you. But when we're in school, there might be a subject that comes easily to us and we just breeze right through it without even bothering with the homework. And then there are the subjects that no amount of homework can seem to unlock the mystery. Even with the best tutor. How many of us have had a life experience where once we were out in the world, it just clicked? Ah, that's the way it works. I mean, how long did it take for that lesson to kick in? Are you still waiting for that aha moment? Well, the disciples haven't had it yet. And it won't happen for them for some time. In my previous career of photography, I recall really excellent, enthusiastic instructors teaching us all kinds of things about, you know, lighting, composition, and color theory. And then under their guidance, we'd go to the school studio to practice the classroom instruction. And then the next day, you would get the proofs back, and you'd critique them, and then go back to the school studio to practice the next lesson. And naturally, there would be the banter about whose stuff was better, and it was always just such a great setup that encouraged the growth and the stretch one another's creativity. Gerhard Blocker, he's a German immigrant. He was a giant in photography education back in those days. And I remember thanking him for how much I appreciated his class and that I hoped someday to be half as good of a photographer as he was. And very generously, he takes my hand and he's shaking my arm and he says, I hope you will be twice the photographer I ever will be. be the greatest. I did enjoy some critical success, and I enjoyed many of the relationships that I got to have with clients and all kinds of people I had the opportunity to work with, and the vendors we dealt with. But boy, there was that learning curve of finding out the client was way less interested in what I knew about art and how I could provide for them what it is that they really wanted. I had to find out how to best serve them. And learning takes time. It takes practice. It involves making mistakes. And then learning from those mistakes. And then practicing some more. A patient and inspiring teacher, that's a plus. And a teacher that leads by example, that's the greatest. It took the death and resurrection of Jesus for the disciples to realize that Jesus was not the leader they were looking for. Jesus was the one they needed. And Jesus is still that teacher. Jesus is still teaching us about all the opportunities to be the humble servant. And Peter did finally get it. In his first letter, Peter said, "Each of you has been blessed with one of God's many wonderful gifts to be used in the service of others. So use your gift well." Each of you has been blessed with one of God's many wonderful gifts to be used in the service of others. It might be the gift you bring to serving on a board of this church. Maybe taking a turn as a kids' church teacher of some Sunday. That's a lovely way to share your gift of patience. Your money is a gift that you give as an offering that's used well. Musical talent is a spectacular special gift that we're blessed to have quite a bit of around here. Have you thought about the gifts that have nothing to do with being in this building? Now, it's great to be a servant when there's no opposition and things are going smoothly. But what about when the critics start? What about when we are misunderstood? Or when people question our motivation? Why are you doing that? Why are you doing it that way? Who would you rather be in that moment? Critic? The person who has walked away or ignores what needs done? Can you still be the servant? Being a servant is a mindset where each day you make yourself open to Jesus and ask, "What gift do you want me to share today, Jesus?" Maybe you're supposed to reassure somebody who's struggling to make sense of their life and that there is hope and forgiveness. It may be to offer cheerful diversion for the person with the cranky kid at the store. It may be just to listen to the person that needs someone to hear them without judgment. Wherever, however, Jesus needs us, we are challenged to respond, "Here I am, Jesus, I am your servant." each of you have been blessed with one of God's many wonderful gifts. Not all of them, but one. And that gift is to be used in the service of others. And Jesus promises you will do something great. And Peter reminds us to use your gift well. God, we give back to you this little bit of ourselves. We ask your blessing upon this money to help us to continue to feed the hungry of body and spirit in our own community and to bring hope and healing for people all over the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, as the priest team makes their way back up here, this week, Maundy Thursday, that would be Thursday, we will be having our version of a Passover meal right up here in this space. So we have lamb and all the Middle Eastern fixings, and since lamb does not taste like chicken, we will also have chicken, okay? So that way, if you don't want to try it, you still have, you won't starve. I guess we'll put it that way, okay? Then we follow that that meal with communion, and we have a service of contemplation. So, look forward to seeing you here on Thursday. Well, let's stand. Let's sing.
Thank you.
And the game plan is, we will not be up here. We will be back in the sanctuary. In whatever state of readiness it is, that's where we will be. All right. So I thank you for all the times that you've been up here with us. And it will be lovely to see the transformation that our sanctuary has had. And invite some of you to be with you. Invite some of you to be with you for the world in the body of Christ, reaching out and welcoming all and growing together.